Now, I want to ask you, was this about race? Was this about gender? Or was it really just about the economy and immigration?
We've seen the exit polls, and I was watching your previous interview with TJ, and it's quite clear that Harris wasn't able to mobilize the women's vote, particularly among white women. She wasn't able to resonate as a candidate that could mobilize the female vote, despite, I think, one of the issues that the Harris campaign was able to really put front and center is abortion rights. And this is where I think she was able to get some momentum. But in the end, it wasn't as important as exit polls reveal that it's really the economy, that Donald Trump seemed to know more about managing the economy than Harris. It's about immigration and it's about inflation and prices. So a lot of the Americans felt that they're worse off. And Harris, unfortunately, because she was vice president, was seen more as the incumbent rather than these policies were under collectively under the Biden administration. Because she was really a part of the Biden administration, she wasn't really able to fend off criticism that the worst off Americans was because of the policies of the Biden Harris administration.
Yeah. All right. Now let's talk about how a Trump 2.0 affects the world. What does it mean? I mean, for the US, we know what their issues are, and it was made clear by the American people. But what does this mean to the world? Let's start with this. Number one, climate change. Donald Trump believes climate change is a conspiracy theory. In fact, he doesn't believe climate change is real. Let's start with that.
Right. And this is where I think Trump has the support of many in the Republican Party, because I think this has been a Republican Party position that climate change is not as important. I can distinctly remember when Sarah Palin was running, she was also one of these climate change deniers. And in a way, the shift of the Republican Party to the right in recent decades showed that they don't prioritize climate change. So I think as far as the US is concerned, it will take a step back on climate change, which will not be good because a lot of the other countries in the global north are looking at US leadership on this. That will further embolden China to say that, well, if the US is not going to pay respect in addressing climate change, then why should we? And why should other countries? So without American leadership, the climate change agenda will be left to other possible Western countries like the EU and the rest. And it would be more difficult to push the climate change agenda without US leadership.
Okay, and not only that, when Donald Trump gave his pre-victory speech, he already talked about the US having the most liquid gold. Do you remember? He
Yes.
mentioned that we have the most liquid gold, mostly, which means they'll be digging more.
Yes. So the drill, baby, drill was the mantra of the first Trump administration, and this could have implications, I think, in oil prices. So because the U.S. is not part of OPEC, and therefore, if the policy is to further drill, in a way, that could help ease oil prices for a little bit, but in the end, that may mean that the pursuit of green sources of energy, more renewable sources, will take a back step. And therefore, we will resort to traditional sources of energy like oil, gas, and even coal.
Okay, that's climate change. Now, when it comes to wars, this is the question. Will anything change? Because Trump has said during his administration, there were no wars, which factually to a degree is true, right? I mean, there could be other factors in it, but he was right there. And then during the Biden administration, we've seen Russia attack Ukraine. And then we've seen also, well, Israel and Gaza happen. But as I said, there are many other factors involved, right? But what does this mean now? What could change with a Trump leadership?
Well, Trump will likely still pursue containment of China. in a way, his close relationship with Putin and with Russia is a different dimension. But his campaign has a specifically anti-China slant and sees China as a competitor. However, not necessarily that it will mean that there could be direct military conflict, but as they say, Trump doesn't like wars except trade wars. So there might be conflict, but it will be in the economic sphere. So I highly doubt that Trump will backtrack the trade war that he started with China. And in fact, the tariffs that he imposed on Chinese goods were continued under the Biden administration. So
okay.
So in a way, this policy of ensuring that the U.S. doesn't lose to China's economic positioning in terms of bringing back the industries and de-investing American industries, de-investing in China, that might even benefit Southeast Asian countries because some of these investors will look for other sites. So the key is, how do we get that? How do we capture those investments? And that means we might have to do a lot of policies to make us the attractive option from China.
Okay, now let's move on to politics. With the vitriol, Trump's been called a fascist, right? But at the end of the day, he's been called fascist and populist, right? Over, here's a candidate that was, they were saying was joyful. But then you do have op-ed saying that she was mediocre, she wasn't able to give her message as clearly. And she was struggling with the fact that the Biden administration is rating so poorly today. It's so unpopular. But what does a Trump victory mean for politics all over the world?
We've been seeing, Karen, I lived in Georgia when I was studying 10 years ago. I actually lived in the U.S. for 6 years. And since even before Obama, America has been increasingly polarized. And both parties have become more extreme than before. Republicans swinging further to the right, Democrats swinging further to the left. There's no... there's very little space wherein they agree. They've been increasingly treated each other in a negative way. So this pernicious polarization, which is not only symptomatic of the U.S., but all over the world, right? We even have this version in our own country, tells you that democracy in the world is broken. There's something that happened with the liberal version of democracy that made palatable some of these populist right-wing leaders, and not only palatable, but being able to mobilize voters to give them electoral mandates. So with Trump, I think the polarization will likely disappear. I think it will be heightened. You will be talking to two Americas, the America of Trump and the America of anti-Trump. And this will further define, I guess, American politics. But, you know, this is emulated. And we've seen this in other countries. In fact, we've seen this in countries way before we've seen it in the U.S. The U.S. is simply following the trend. So, for example, we elected, the Philippines elected Duterte even before the U.S. elected Trump. So we're seeing this rise of the strong man. With heavily populist authoritarian styles of political leadership. And under Trump 2.0, that means that this type of leadership is not only valid, but seems to define electoral politics and perhaps democratic politics in the years to come.
Okay. And then here, another question for you is, what happens now? Will it affect the Philippines? I mean, we've seen that Vice President Kamala Harris has been here twice, right? And the relationship between the U.S. and the Philippines is stronger than ever. How will this change, if any, foreign policy? And when it comes to defense and security with the West Philippine Sea?
Right. There's a lot of worry that under Trump 2.0 that this will be completely a pendulum swing away from the deeper and closer ties of the U.S. and the Philippines under Biden and Harris. But Karen, let's remember, the support for the Philippines is bipartisan. So even if you have a Republican president, a Republican Senate, and perhaps even we might see a Republican House. So you're really seeing an extraordinary mandate being given to Trump and the Republican Party in the U.S. The good news is for us in the Philippines is that a lot of Republicans feel that the U.S.-Philippine relationship is an important pillar of U.S.-Asia policy, and that under Trump might even, because we really don't know, Trump is highly uncertain, highly volatile. We don't really know the people he's going to appoint in positions that will affect U.S.-Philippine alliance and relations. But from before Trump 1.0, we can see that Trump didn't really leave the Philippines behind. When Mike Pompeo visited the Philippines, he was, in fact, the first to give that ironclad commitment right after the arbitral award was given in 2016. So we might see Trump, he might not really like the alliance itself. He has a disdain for traditional alliances because he feels that the allies need to pay more and to stop free riding on the U.S. But what's good is that under the Marcos Jr. administration, we're willing to pay for our own defense. We've been increasingly, this new law that was signed on self-defense posturing, that means that there's a shift in our foreign policy and security establishment that we're willing to subsidize our own defense. And if Trump is saying that, well, you need to pay up more if you want U.S. commitment, then I think what's good about the Marcos Jr. administration is that it's willing to do so.
Yeah. And I agree with you, Professor Arugay. The Marcos administration has taken a different tact when it comes to the West Philippine Sea. One is, they call it, right, transparency. There's a term they use.
Transparency initiative.
Transparency initiative, wherein we know what's happening in the West Philippine Sea. It's the first time it's happened. There are videos. It's reported. It's released to the media. Some said that's too much of microphone diplomacy. But in the end, it caused more of a multilateralism dialogue, right? Our allies have come together. So it's not just the U.S.
Yes. And I think the good thing and about the Marcos Jr. administration is that it hasn't put all the country's strategic eggs in the U.S. basket. Yes. We're seeing, and I think this is part of contingent planning on the part of our defense establishment, that they're in the contingency that the U.S. under Trump might disengage, because that's a possibility. We don't really know. The transactional nature of Trump policy tells us that we have to plan for the worst case scenario. And the worst case scenario is that the U.S. might disengage, albeit gradually, in Asia, and really just deal with China on a one-on-one basis rather than on a multilateral basis. And this is why deepening cooperation with other like-minded states, so the RAA with Japan, the Comprehensive Partnership with Australia, with EU countries like France and Germany, all these means that we're diversifying our defense and security cooperation, so much so that it would be great if the U.S. remains committed to the alliance. That will help us in our defense posture. But if not, then we have plan B, we have plan C. And I just hope that these commitments gather more momentum, meaning let's not dribble the ball and wait. Let's fasten and accelerate these commitments, because for the next 4 years, if Trump policy in Asia is going to be that I'm going to deal China on my own, I don't really care about the other partners, then we have to prepare for that. But if the Trump policy is that, oh, it's great that the Philippines is standing up to China, I think I'll support the Philippines in this regard, because, you know, they're paying the high cost of standing up to a bully, then that will be beneficial for us as well.
All right. On that note, thank you for this. Professor Arugay, political science professor at the University of the Philippines. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.